Welcome to the Extra Podcast. This is episode number 245. Producing our episode once again is our silent producer, Poochie, Matt Crocker. Matt.
Wheelie, wee, wheelie, wiggity whack. To the extreme.
That's what Poochie does, right?
That's the worst Poochie I've ever heard. That was good. That's a good way to
For those of you who wonder what we're talking about when we say Poochie, you need to go to YouTube and you need to Google Simpsons Poochie episode. Yeah. P-O-O-C-H-I-E. Then that guy, that dog looks exactly like Matt Crocker.
All right. Silent producer.
Mm-hmm.
Matt, I'd especially like to point out that today there's only three of us and you're still silent producing. That's a tough gig. We should have put him at the mic.
No.
No. also, joining
just like
me
Homer was robbed of the mic, it's true. So is Poochie.
That's right. Pastor Paul's with us today.
Hey.
And Pastor Jeff is here also.
Wiggly, wiggly, wet.
Greg, you're sounding extra sultry today.
Well, I'm hosting.
You have this crackle to your voice.
I was going to say, you're trying to reach the dulcet tones, but you're not able to get there.
This is my hosting voice. Welcome to the Extra Podcast. Easy listening for your theological needs.
Nice.
Does that work?
No, you have a tenor voice. You need a baritone.
I'm a baritone. Hey guys, it was the Oscars this weekend.
Yes.
Did you guys watch it?
No.
I did not watch it.
Apparently, it was the least watched Oscars since 2008.
Exactly have good press leading up to
2008.
It.
Well, they were freaking out because there were no African American or any kind of actually minority nominees.
But I heard that they planned on having a lot of African Americans giving out the awards.
Yeah.
Because that's visually better.
They did that, yes. And there were quite a few there. They went overboard trying to correct the whole thing.
Oh man!
Right, and then because everybody thought it was racist against African Americans, then Chris Rock made a joke about Asians instead because that's better.
I know, and there were so many Asians who were nominated too.
Yeah,
it's funny. It was just all white people who were nominated, which is, I mean, if you think about the movies, it's all white. It's all rich white people for the most part. So that was the critique. Although, isn't Hollywood getting to the point now where it's the most legalistic?
What do you mean when you watch the movies, it's only rich white people?
The rich white people are the ones who are acting. All the big movies have rich white people in them. There's very few that don't. Like, quite honestly, the guy who played in Creed, Michael B. Jordan, he was great. Hmm. He did a great job. He should have been nominated. There's no question about that. But, you know, in Will Smith, I was surprised that he didn't get a nomination for that. I think, though, that people, I don't know, he doesn't have quite the name.
Do you mean it's people voting?
No, the people who are acting. They're rich white people.
Okay.
Well, all the movies. Most of the movies have rich white
people.
The
man, Greg, the man.
Okay.
No? You don't think so?
No, you just listed
the actors
are
rich white people.
Two black lead actors.
Right. So how many more are there like them compared to how many rich white people are acting?
Yeah, fair enough.
So I'm just saying that. Like one of the things Chris Rock said during the episode was that there was a time where he was, you know, President Obama showed up and they were at a party and he and like there were four other black guys in the room, and out of like 1,000 people in the room, there's four black people in one of the most liberal societies around, right? And that's what I'm saying, that he's right, that there's very few minorities in that area. Very few in the Hollywood kind of... Hollywood's like a high school. You know, it's like there's 2,000 or 3,000 people who all know each other and hang out. And it is like one of the whitest high schools around. So, which is interesting because for so many years, Hollywood has kind of portrayed itself as being, you know, representative of all the good things in the world and, you know, immune. We're solving the world's problems, right? Which is ironic because they're rich. They're filthy. Louis C.K. stands up and talks about how they're all going to go home wealthy. They are all wealthy. Multi-millionaires all sitting in the room together. White millionaires who are decrying businesses and their involvement in the world when they're signing, you know, the reason they have so much money is because of those very businesses, and most of them are in bed with the business. It just, it's all a mess. It's just I struggle with the Academy Awards because of the hypocrisy of so much of what it's so moralistic, right? Everybody gets up and they have to have a new thing that they say about, you know, this is my particular agenda. The earth is too hot. LGBT stuff, transgender. I think Mad Max became apparently about transgendered movement. This looks like what? No, it's a movie about feminism, but it's not about transgendered movement. Like, there's one of the ladies who won for the Mad Max. She was, I think, the not costume, but the makeup designer.
Okay. Yeah.
She stood up and she said, "You know, the world could be like this soon. Really, the world's gonna be like the Namibian desert soon." So now Mad Max is a movie about climate change. So everybody's got their own, you know, moralistic political thing that they're going to stand up and they're going to espouse for a few minutes. And I like living in that kind of legalistic society, because that's what that is. It's way more legalistic than the most legalistic church I've ever been in. You don't dare do something wrong according to these particular rules, or you'll be an outcast. Just ask Mel Gibson. Like, you just can't break the rules, which is why I find it so, I love film, but the people who make them are so hypocritical, just like the rest of us who all need Jesus. And that's the other part that's, I every time I watch the Academy Awards, I would love to see Christians be able to infiltrate that and be able to present Christ in a winsome way to these dear folks, because they desperately need it, right? But they're so insulated from it because they have all the money and all the success and all the things that our world say is valuable, and they have people surrounding them all the time talking about how great they are. So if God opposes the proud and gives grace to the humble, their whole world is about pride.
Yeah.
Right? They're being reaffirmed in their pride every moment of every day. And it's so hard. So hard. That was a rant. I just realized I just ranted about the Academy Awards. I apologize.
No, that's kind of what we do here.
Oh, yeah. But I still enjoyed watching it. Although it's interesting how many people are less and less inclined to watch these days. And I think a lot of it has to do with people getting sick of having the politics of this high school in Southern California shoved down their throats.
Poochie, did you watch it? He nodded yes. Nice. Live? Wow.
How can you watch it live? Oh, it's interminable.
He watched the Grammys too.
Lasts so long.
You know, Poochie is committed to the award shows. He also watched The Ring.
And the Golden Globes?
He's pointing to, he's married. Poochie's married.
In the Golden Globes.
And his wife wants to watch things like the Grammys and the Oscars, and so he sits there, and so he listens and watches, and he plays his Game Boy.
Okay, so, yeah.
It's good.
See, even my wife doesn't like watching it. She would like to see like the fashions and stuff, right? Because some of the dresses are really pretty and all that, but even that, she's like, ugh, whatever. Wouldn't you like to go someday, though? I would.
To the Oscars?
Yeah, man.
As a seat filler?
I don't care.
As a rich white guy?
Yeah. Well, I'm not going to be a rich white guy. I'm going to be a white guy, but I'm not going to be rich. So, like, I'm a white guy, so that, what, I'm already 80% there.
Yeah. You could be pastor to the stars.
Oh, are you happy that the Spotlight won?
I didn't see.
Surprise, surprise. a movie praising journalists was voted by journalists to be the best movie.
Wow. You're a little cynical about that.
Oh, hey, the year before, a movie about the movie industry was voted by the movie industry to be the best movie.
Which was that?
Birdman.
The Birdman.
I'm sorry. it's funny to me whenever there's a movie about the people who are voting, praising them. They're like, oh, yeah, that's the best one. Easily.
See, the Birdman.
Brooklyn was the best movie last year.
This is why the People's Choice Awards is probably better.
Right.
Because the people get to choose.
But then it's just the popularity.
What about the Teen Choice?
That's better because you get like goo thrown on people.
Is that really true?
Yeah.
Yeah,
like there's goo every year, right? You watch the Teen Choice.
Yeah, Poochie watches.
Poochie said, yes, there's goo.
Yeah. Yeah.
Wow, you really are into the award seasons, Poochie. I love it.
You get a surfboard, I think. That's your...
you do get a surfboard from the Teen Choice Awards.
Yeah.
That's right.
Just like Poochie.
Just like Poochie. Hey, we have a few questions that people sent in.
Good.
Which is a good thing.
Just a few. But before we get to those, we wanted to add our own because there was a... We've had a few emails sent after the sermon this past weekend from Psalm 15.
Mm.
We had our baptism services, so if you were in the worship center at 9 and 11, you would have not seen Jeff's sermon. But if you were in Center Court or West Court or Saturday Night Worship Center, you would have seen his sermon. But you can watch it online, either way. One of the questions that, Jeff, you had a few times over email and in person was to do with the verse 2 in Psalm 15 says that he who walks blamelessly and does what is right and speaks truth in his heart. It's talking about those kinds of people who...
Yeah, who can dwell with the Lord? No, right. Who can dwell with the Lord? Or as the last verse says, who can stand with him forever? Is that the way it reads, Paul?
Yep. Shall never be moved.
Shall never be moved. Yeah.
So people brought up to you the cases of people like Rahab or the Hebrew midwives who were lying and all kinds of other scenarios where people who are not being truthful are actually being commended by God in the scriptures. And yet here you have people being commended for always being truthful.
So that's the question is, so in real terms today, you have missionaries who smuggle Bibles into closed countries or who might set up a business in a foreign country that's closed to God's word. And so, although I would say the second of those is not necessarily lying because they are setting up a business there, but their goal might be proclamation of the scriptures. So the smuggling one is a real one. Here you are, you're going through the border, and they say, do you have anything with you? And you say, no. So I told a story about how I went through the border and had some Tylenol 1s with me, and I told the truth about it, which was good because apparently I'm a drug mule now, stuff like anyway. But I told this story and asked the question, do you lie at the border? And the reason I said that is because it's so commonplace and one of those kind of, I don't know, Jerry Bridges calls it a respectable sin, right? That they're big lies. You don't tell big lies, right? You don't do that kind of thing. But you tell the little lies, like going through the border and whether you have something with you, is something that we would kind of give an excuse to. So the question that was being raised by actually a couple different people was, all right, but aren't there, do we always have to speak honestly? Do we always have to tell the truth? Because in the Bible, you've got places where people don't tell the truth. So how does that work with our ethics? How does that work with our understanding of that sort of thing?
Right. So is lying always a sin? Is every form, or when we're talking about what Rahab did, was that actually...
What did Rahab do for those of us who... We should talk about both as examples, because in the Bible, the two main examples that are given are Rahab, when she houses the spies, and then lies about their presence with her to the authorities in the city of Jericho. And then there's the situation with the Hebrew midwives who are told by the Pharaoh to kill all the newborn male children. And as a means of basically of, you know, thinning out the Hebrew population, and they don't do it.
Right.
They refuse to do it, but then lie to him saying, hey, no, they're just really, the women give birth faster than we can get there, which is not true.
Right.
So they're commended for their faithfulness. Both Rahab and the Hebrew midwives are commended for their faithfulness. So here they're liars commended for their faithfulness. And yet the Bible in Psalm 15 says you should speak honestly. So, and those who dwell with God.
So in Rahab's lies, what was she doing? She was protecting.
Right.
People. She's protecting lives.
Right. So there was the way of God
in
Rahab's situation. There was the way of God and what the Lord wanted. And she aligns herself with what the Lord wants over against what her society wants.
Right.
Likewise, in the Hebrew midwives situation, you have the way of the Lord, who the Hebrew midwives align themselves with over against a society that is against the Lord. So I think we could say that we tell the truth. We are truth tellers because God is a God of truth. And that is the major note in the scriptures. But there is this minor note in the scriptures that says there is a law that exists above the laws of our land. And the law of God supersedes the law of our land in every place. So if the law of our land is asking us to do something that is a breakage of God's law, then we have a responsibility, I would think, not just an option, but a responsibility to act in line with God's law as opposed to the law of the land. So this applies to, I mean, you guys pick out some people from the history.
Well,
of the
if we think of the hiding place with Corrie Ten Boom and her family hiding Jews, right? Like they build this fake wall in a bedroom and they hide Jews behind it when the Nazis come and look. And the Nazis come, like, they're looking and they're looking, are you hiding anybody here? No, we're not hiding anybody. But they were doing good because they were protecting lives from a wicked regime that was coming to actually exterminate, in would have been their words, of a certain group of people. And that completely goes against who God is and what God wants us to do. So Corrie Ten Boom and the whole Ten Boom family, we're actually following God's law
and should be commended for that.
Yes.
Likewise, the civil rights movement of the 1960s with Martin Luther King Jr. leading it. I mean, you can make criticisms about MLK in lots of other areas, but in the guts of what he was trying to argue there, when he writes his letters from the Birmingham jail, this is his argument in the end. Look, there is a law that exists above the law. So when we don't obey the segregation laws, or when we don't obey the laws that say that we are less than human, we are actually walking in line with a law that supersedes the law of the land, and that is the law of God. Likewise, the Nuremberg trials at the end of World War II, the reason that because the argument was among the Nazis, we were following orders, like we're supposed to I'm working in a prison camp or an extermination camp, and I'm not supposed to follow the orders of the boss.
And what they were doing under German law was legal.
Right. Not only legal, it was a command from the authorities at the time. The Final Solution was a command from the authorities. And it was, if you're in the military, you're being commanded to go and to do this particular act. And so the Nuremberg trial came along, and that was the chief defense of the Nazis who were on trial there. We were following orders. How can you tell us that for us to follow our culture, for us to follow our national law was wrong when you guys are following your national law and it's right? And the argument of the prosecutors and ultimately the judges there was that there's a law that exists above the law, right? Which is funny too, because now we've eliminated that law. So when you get into the gay marriage debates, this is the same argument that people were making, that no, we were not going to say gay marriage is right in the States or Canada or whatever, because there is a law that exists above the law. So even though you guys are saying, oh no, this is right, we answer to the Lord, right? Mm-hmm. Isn't this what Daniel did?
Yes.
So in the end, our responsibility is to God, and sometimes that's going to put us offside with the culture in which we live. I think our prayer, 1 Timothy 2, is to live quiet lives, peaceful, right? At minding our own business, working with our hands. That's the language of the scriptures. Because I don't want to get offside with the government. I want governments that are just and righteous and those sorts of things. But there are times that the government is going to ask us to do things, or our bosses, or the military, or whatever, are going to ask us and even demand us to do things that are not we cannot do, whether it's pinching a bit of incense to Caesar and becoming idolaters, or this is the claim. I mean, you can debate this, but there's a claim about people who don't want to bake cakes for gay weddings in the States. They feel, no, wait a minute, you're asking me to give endorsement, at least in their minds, they're giving an endorsement to a sin. And they're like, I can't go there. I love you. I'll bake you cake in any other circumstance, your birthday, everything like that, because I'm not endorsing your sin by doing that.
Right.
But when I have to do it for your wedding, I have to do it. My point is that we have a law that exists above the law that we adhere to. So how does that work out nowadays?
Well, before we get there, though, my question is, how often are we bringing up the cases of Rahab and the Hebrew midwives because we want to be Bible smugglers? And how often are we bringing those
up? No, boat smugglers, brother.
Right, boats, right. So how do we...
So what you're asking is when we go across a border.
Yeah.
Okay, so take real life situation. You're driving across the border, and here where we live in Abbotsford, we're on the U.S. border. And so you're driving back from you know, Bellingham, where you've purchased, you know, 8 pairs of shoes or whatever it is, and you're coming back across the border.
Or a case of wine.
Case of wine, whatever mm-hmm. it is that you think is just outside the bounds. And you're like, well, I don't need to, like, why would I... So I mean, I've seen, when I used to live in Bellingham, I've seen people put in like 8 layers of shirts, right? Which would have made them really hot. And they got the air conditioning on in the car in the middle of January because they're wearing 8 shirts so that they don't know, but they're not going to claim the 8 shirts. So you come back across the border, you say, don't claim, don't do it. And then you feel justified. And I'm not saying people would do this, but people then might point to the scriptures and say, see, Rahab. So how's that different? Is that what you're asking?
Yeah, I'm asking the question, the motivation.
So if we're smuggling Bibles across the border is different than smuggling codeine, right, Jeff?
Yeah, totally. In what way? Principalize that. That's
so,
a good
yes,
point. But
yeah, so Jeff shared a story in his sermon about how when he was traveling to the U.S. and he took some Tylenol ones with him to give to his father-in-law because his father-in-law wanted them. But the guy at the border said, you bringing anything? And he said, yeah, I'm bringing Tylenol ones for my father-in-law, blah, blah, blah. And the guy was like, you know, codeine's prescription down here. So essentially what you're doing is bringing in an illegal narcotic that's just like heroin. And Jeff, of course, was surprised. He's not intending to be bringing illegal drugs across or anything. And the guy, you know, he was kind to Jeff and he didn't have any issues. But bringing that across, trying to smuggle it across. So if Jeff would have lied about that, that would have been different than saying going into. So for instance, for a story from history, Brother Andrew was a missionary who would smuggle Bibles into Soviet countries where they were illegal. So it's different because in the Soviet countries, their call is the ultimate law is the state. Mm-hmm. You essentially worship the state, and you cannot worship God. So bringing Bibles across the border was bringing something that brings God's truth. It brings the gospel. It brings the light of Christ to people. Whereas bringing codeine across the border in order to give to somebody is not bringing the light of the gospel. It's bringing mm-hmm. something it's the law of the land.
Right.
You can't bring it in. Mm-hmm. But a Bible actually,
which is not the law of the land, is not in opposition to the law of God at that point.
Right.
It's mm-hmm. the places at which the law of God supersedes and is clear in clear opposition to the law of the land that one would have the
yes.
permission. And I again, not just permission, but I would say moral obligation to go with God's law mm-hmm. as opposed to the law of the land. So this is the challenge. We're selfish people, and so ultimately we want to utilize some of these things for our own personal benefits. Mm-hmm. And so we have to be very careful in thinking about it and realize, okay, well, why is it? As you, Greg, you said, like, what is my motivation to do this? Mm-hmm. Is the law that I am breaking at this point actually a law that stands over against the law of God? And by doing so, am I actually acting morally? Mm. Or am I just using this as an excuse so that I can have a bigger boat or more t-shirts or more wine that's cheaper or whatever?
Right.
Right. Because ultimately, by doing that, so if it's not a breakage of the law of God, if the law of the land and the law of God are actually, you know, synonymous at that point, to go against the law of the land is to go against the law of God. Hmm. And ultimately, it's to act in independence from him. Because essentially what you're saying to God is, you can't take care of me in my own country, buying the things there for the prices there. I need to go down to this other place and do this and lie in order to live the good life. Hmm. And it's an act of blatant rebellion.
Well, the milk
to
is
him.
Cheaper.
And so I'm just saying, look, this is something I've done. Everybody has done this. We do this frequently, a lot of us. And I'm just saying that for Christians, we are truth tellers. That's what we are. It should mark us. And unfortunately, it doesn't. And so what do? We come to Jesus and we ask, we repent and we seek his forgiveness, right? Daily. Mm. Forgive us our debts as we forget those who are indebted to us, which is the Lord's Prayer. So we daily make these appeals to God and ask for his forgiveness and certainly for his empowerment by the Spirit to live in a better way going forward.
Mm. That's great. Hey, another question. This one has to do with the topic of hell. And the listener writes in saying that Ezra, in a sermon that he gave on February 20th, mentioned that Jesus warns of hell far more than he talks about heaven. And then the listener asks, because they're aware of a lot of churches and teachers and preachers who are denying the existence of hell by arguing that the Bible doesn't talk about it, how do we respond? What are some scriptures that talk about hell? How can we prove that it is an important doctrine? So Ezra's saying Jesus talks about it. This listener's experience is that they know churches and pastors and teachers who are denying its existence. How do we move forward and engage with people who would say that hell, as we know it, is a fabrication or is a unfair leap from the biblical data?
So maybe we'll just start by giving some texts that seem to speak in relatively clear terms about hell. A couple of you guys might want to grab the couple of ones out of Revelation here. Revelation 14 being one, and I think Revelation 20, 21, something. But I here's Mark 9. You want to start with that?
I've got Matthew 25.
Where you go?
But
no, let me do Mark 9.
Yeah,
and then
you do Mark
9. 20. Okay,
yeah.
Here's one. Whoever causes one of these little ones, Jesus speaking here, whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to sin, it would be better for him if a great millstone were hung around his neck and he were thrown in the sea. Notice that it would be better to be thrown into the sea. So in order for you to die in the present world,
right?
Okay,
yeah,
is a better
yes.
situation than what's going to happen to you if you cause one of these little ones to sin.
Mm-hmm.
So, and if your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. It's better for you to enter life crippled and with two hands and go to hell, or the Greek word there, Gehenna, to the unquenchable fire. So it gives a description now
mm-hmm.
of what that Gehenna is.
Yep.
And if your foot causes you to sin, cut it off. It's better for you to enter life lame than with 2 feet and be thrown into Gehenna, to hell. And if your eye causes you to sin, tear it out. It's better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than with two eyes to be thrown into hell. Okay, so hell is where their worm does not die and the fire is not quenched. For everyone will be salted with fire. Salt is good, but the salt has lost its saltiness. How will you make it salty again? Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another. And you get some descriptions of what hell's like here. It's unquenchable fire. Mm-hmm. We can debate about whether that's a metaphor or a literal fire or whatever. That doesn't matter to me. The fact that it's not quenched, the fact that somebody who goes there, it's worse for them than it would be for them to die at the bottom of a sea with a millstone around their neck.
Yeah.
The context here seems to indicate that there's some kind of eternal, long-lasting anyway, bad thing that happens to someone that makes being crippled or blind or whatever a preferable option than
right.
going there.
Right. So the argument of people who are saying that, so they would say, oh, this Gehenna, this was just a place. It was a dump outside of Israel where people would throw their trash and things that they don't need anymore. And they would say, Jesus is just saying, he's saying that's the worst it could get is to be thrown into that place. But like you just said, when you look at it in the whole context of the passage, being thrown into, you know, he's saying it would be better to be thrown into the lake, into the ocean with a millstone around your neck. So what would be, from a physical perspective, why would that be better? If Gehenna is just the physical
right.
Place on earth.
Right. Doesn't make any sense.
Doesn't at all.
The other thing that should be noted here is that whole garbage dump outside of Jerusalem thing, that comes from a 12th century rabbi. We're not entirely sure whether or not that was actually what was going on during the first century. So that's, I mean, because we don't have a lot of that reference. The language, it was a Valley of Hinnom, and it was where they used to do child sacrifices. That's the more, that's the better historical background to what it was. Jesus sure seems to be drawing on that image, right?
Yeah.
That somebody gets slaughtered there in a, in an everlasting sense. Although there are those who will say, well, but yeah, it's not, it's not, the fire isn't quenched, but the people in the fire are, right? Again, though, why would it be better for them to have a millstone tied around their neck and go to the bottom of the sea than to go there if
right.
that's the case? So you've got some problems there. There seems to be an everlasting sense to the of judgment, regard whatever that judgment, fire, whatever. It's really bad, and it's everlasting sense. Matthew 25 actually gives more indication of that everlasting sense.
Right. So when you read Matthew 25 and you go to starting in verse 31 through to the end of verse 46, he's talking about separating the ones, the sheep from the goats, those on his right being the sheep, those on his left being the goats. And he says in verse 41, he says, then he says to those on the left, depart from me, you cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. So if there's this eternal fire where that's prepared for the devil and his angels, and those who haven't followed Christ, those who haven't put their faith in him, are cast into that eternal fire. This isn't something that's just temporary on earth. This is something that is eternal and that will last.
Right, and the language at the end of that passage is interesting because we try to figure out, well, what does eternal mean? There are those who are going to argue it's of the ages, which is in Greek, can function that way, right? So does that mean, you know, a qualitatively better life? It's just, it's a fire. Anyway, really bad fire as opposed to, or a really great, if you talk about eternal life, a really great life. Or is it talking about a duration of time? And so you get to the end of that chapter, and truly, truly, I say to you, Jesus says in verse 45 of Matthew 25, truly, I say to you, as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. Verse 46, and these, the goats, will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I have no other way to read that but recognize that whatever you're going to say about the life is what you have to say about the punishment. It's the same adjective.
Yeah.
So the way language works is that in that kind of near context, we mean the same thing by the mirroring of the adjective with that noun. Do you understand what I mean by that? Like, if eternal has something to do with punishment, it also has something to do with life, and it's the same thing. Which means you and I don't know anybody who would say, "Hey, yeah, after he died, Jesus promises eternal life, and that means a long time."
Right.
So if that's the case, then you also have to say, well, he's also talking about a long time of conscious bad something for the person who is being judged.
Yeah.
So you get this language. And it's interesting that you use that language of the devil and the angels, because that's in Revelation. Mm. That's where he gets it. Do you have that text, Revelation?
I have 20 in front of me.
That's fine. Revelation 14 works as well.
Right. So Revelation 20 is talking about the book of life, and those who whose names were not written in the book were thrown into the lake of fire. It's the second death. Anyone whose name was not found in the book of life was thrown into the lake of fire. And earlier was talking about how this was a ongoing thing, but that's not the text you were thinking of. You were thinking of 14.
Yeah, Revelation 20 is interesting because it talks about how it was prepared for the devil and his angels.
Mm.
Right, so here's this fire, devil and angels, and it sure seems to be the same fire that's being spoken about in Matthew 25. And then you get to Revelation 14, verse 9, and another angel, a third, followed them, saying with a loud voice, if anyone worships the beast and its image and receives a mark on his forehead or on his hand, he will also drink the wine of God's wrath, poured full strength in the cup of his anger, and he will be tormented with fire and sulfur in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. And the smoke of their torment goes up forever and ever. And they have no rest, day or night, these worshipers of the beast and its image and whoever receives the mark of its name. So it's difficult to get around these texts. You have to play, you really do have to play exegetical gymnastics to do this. or just flatly say, well, that just doesn't make any sense or isn't kind or isn't whatever to say it. But to claim that the Bible does not speak of this in clear terms is just not true. It does.
And I think some people who will try to dodge the issue by making the whole, there is no word for hell in Greek. It's Gehenna, and it means this, and it means that. And I think they're missing the forest for the trees, because they don't look at the language of judgment or the other images that get brought up besides just Gehenna. So they're trying to attack the doctrine by attacking the term.
Right.
Rather than dealing with the content of what the term is trying to represent.
Yeah. And you have to understand at that point, once you establish, as I think we have, and there are lots more texts and arguments that could be placed here, both philosophical and biblical, you're left with the fact that hell exists, that it was prepared for the devil and his angels, and that people will actually be there as well. And that is like terrifying to me, to you, not just on a personal level, but for my friends. Mm. And so it's that crisis in our hearts and minds, a good, loving God sending somebody to hell that we feel we have to get out of. And so as a result, we want to fiddle with the nature of hell, and we want to say, well, it doesn't exist, therefore God's only loving. We want to fiddle with some of the things that the Bible says about God sending someone there. We don't like that language, and yet he's tormented in the presence of the Lamb, it says in Revelation 14. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, it sounds like God is actually judging. Mm-hmm. It's not just people judging themselves, although there's a sense in which some of that happens. The Lord hands over people to judgment, Romans 1. But we want to get out from underneath that feeling. And you have to understand, I totally appreciate all of those desires, because I feel the same thing everybody else feels. I don't want to lie about what the Bible says at this point. And so what are we left with? We're left with a doctrine that doesn't sit all that easily in our gut, but it probably doesn't sit easily in our gut because, one, we don't recognize how holy God is. And two, we don't recognize how sinful we are. And three, we don't realize what in God's economy, that gap between his holiness and our sinfulness actually demands justice-wise. Mm. So, and the question that the Bible actually is dealing with, most of the New Testament is dealing with, is not, is God loving? It's actually, is God just? Like, everyone assumes, my point there is that everyone assumes, the New Testament writers assume that God is holy and high and lifted up. He is. He is magnificent. And we're not. And so it's trying to deal with the question, what do we do when God is so great and we are so not? Like, is there any way for this great God to dwell with such a sinful people? And so the answers that you get in places like Romans and other places are dealing with that question. That's not really the question that we deal with today. Our question today is more, yeah, but is God loving? Because we think of ourselves as being really good people, which is so funny to me, because seriously, the Pharisees were way better than us at every point.
Mm. Right.
But we think of ourselves as being really good people, deserving of a really good God. I mean, maybe, I don't know, is that effect of the self-esteem movement? Is that effect of just individualism as a whole? But we think of ourselves being wonderful, and it's really unfair for God to judge us for these things, because if anything, we're the victims. And yeah, there might be some truth in the fact that we might be victims at this point or that, and I don't deny that, but we're also complicit. Like, we're complicit with breaking God's world, and what does that mean? So a lot of this, we make sense of God, or of the doctrine of hell, in a wider framework of theology that recognizes the greatness of God, that recognizes the sinfulness of humanity. Do you see what I mean saying? Mm-hmm. Like, if you separate the doctrine of hell from all of these other theological ideas that the Bible states, it looks weird. Mm. But if you place it back within the framework that the scriptures have for who God is, who we are, what justice demands, all that kind of stuff, it slots in like a puzzle piece. And you're like, oh, yes, I see. Mm. So some churches don't want to do that. They don't want to slot it back in. And as a result, because it's tied to these other doctrines, they end up doing something weird to who God is, and certainly something weird to what we're like, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And that's where the problem comes in. And so the question ultimately is that was asked to us was, how do you minister to people, you know, even personally, who are rejecting this doctrine? Any thoughts?
Well, I think if they're people, like if they're loved ones of yours, so someone who is maybe a part of your family or a neighbor, or somebody, a coworker who you have a good relationship with, and you're having a discussion, I mean, you don't have to fight over it. You can just open up the scriptures and you can come to these passages and say, and look at this. Like, mm-hmm. is the scripture, so if this is another Christian that you're dealing with, are the scriptures the authority over our lives, and are the scriptures true in everything mm-hmm. that they say? And if they are, then we have to look and go, it says this, so what are we going to do with that? Are we just going to ignore it? Are we going to try to twist it? Or are we going to actually take God at his word?
Mm-hmm. I think we need to identify too with the challenge. Something I don't often like that I hear in me and others is that sometimes we are trying so hard to defend the orthodox position on this that we don't recognize the gut feeling that we all have over this.
Right.
So I often want to say, yeah, you know what? I get what you're saying. I understand. Like it's a genuine question.
Yeah,
it's one that
point.
I feel.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing I think we need to do, though, and the reason I brought up the wider framework, right, is I think that in order to address questions like this, we need to, it's not just about the question or the text that deal with that particular issue. It's about the wider framework of who God is and how he's revealed in Scripture. Mm-hmm. And so taken as a whole, the Bible has a certain flavor to it, and or it's a certain kind of puzzle, and this piece fits as part of that greater puzzle. But if you don't have that greater puzzle, you'll always think it's weird. Likewise, I mean, I'd say this about God's sexual ethics and everything else. If you want to just look at each text individually, there's a way for you to argue around each little passage or whatever. They're not good. They're not exegetically satisfying to me to say, oh, this passage that deals with same sex this or that is wrong, or we've always interpreted wrong. It fits within a wider framework of what God has been doing in the entire Bible, the way that he has made people as male and female. Like, there's a whole gamut. It's within the marriage, and right? Which is a picture of what the marriage supper between the Lamb and the...
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Like, so yeah, there's this whole bigger picture that it fits within. Mm. And so I think that we need to do better at helping our friends and neighbors understand the whole of the Bible. It's one of the reasons we teach a theology class on Thursday mornings, because we want to put all of those pieces in people's minds, and there might be little gaps or fuzzy parts of the puzzle that we can't quite, you know, figure out how that piece kind of fits exactly. But for the most part, there is a pretty discernible puzzle that fits together in what the scriptures are teaching.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's actually a couple of like, if you want to look at the scriptures as God's grand story of redemption and what he's been doing throughout all of history, there's actually a couple of good kids' Bibles that even for grown-ups to read are good, because it gives a good summary. So, like, there's one called God's Big Picture Story Bible by a guy named David Helm, which is really good. And then another one is the Jesus Storybook Bible, mm-hmm. which shows how Jesus is all the scriptures from beginning to end point to Jesus and the need for him. Mm. So, yeah.
Yeah, I'm totally espousing teaching theology and learning it first for yourself. Mm-hmm. And then I think that would help you communicate and interact with your friends and neighbors, mm-hmm. right? Because we're trying to understand why it is that people are abandoning that particular doctrine, and I'm trying to say it's not just that doctrine they're abandoning.
Right. Mm-hmm.
It's tied to lots of other things that they're abandoning. And mm-hmm. to reconfigure that doctrine means to do more work than just, you know, rebuilding that room in your house. There's a whole foundation that needs to be redone here. You ever had that? You know, you go and you do a renovation project, and they end up saying, well, actually, the reason this room fell into the ground is because the foundation underneath it's rubbish. So we're going to have to rip your whole house down. Sorry.
Right.
And then you end up rebuilding. But the one you've got afterwards, you're thankful for. It's hard in the process. It really is, because you want to do the cheap thing and try to fix that one room. But theology is not like that. Sometimes you just have to flat admit, okay, so my whole theological paradigm stinks. So let's go back to the scriptures and reestablish some of the basics, the fundamentals, so that we can build from that foundation up. And then you'll find 3-4 years down the track that you actually have a theological framework that makes sense of the Bible. It's one thing Spurgeon used to say. He used to hold his Bible up, and he said that people ask him, what kind of theology do you have? He said, I want to have a kind of theology where I can open up to any page in this book, Bible, can open up to any page in this book and not be ashamed. Hmm. And I think that's, yeah. You shouldn't feel like you have to hide the Bible away.
Mm-hmm.
So if you weren't able to make it to Thursday Theology, what's some ways that people can engage in this process?
Yeah, this is what we do. I think a lot with our TLC, we're trying to put stuff together with our TLC program next year. We might have some classes that you might be able to take in the middle of the day that are tied to some theological education pieces we're doing here at the church. We're trying to have that. I would think that we would want you to get into community group, because I think that those are the sorts of places that you're going to end up discussing stuff like this and learning together. Hmm. Yeah, there's lots of different ways that you can do this. Thursday mornings is not that bad, though.
Well, and even if you can't make it, Grudem has a really... Grudem is the textbook we use. Do we use it because we agree with everything he writes?
No.
So why do we choose?
Because
to
it's the most accessible systematic theology textbook around.
Okay.
Accessible meaning like it's understandable. Mm-hmm. When you read it, it's in regular English, and it doesn't use all sorts of weird theological terms that you feel like are way above you.
Right. Mm-hmm. So if you're interested in podcasts, Grudem has a really great audio version of basically every chapter of his book. So if you're a podcast listener and you haven't found it already, you should listen to his Systematic Theology podcast. You can get it on iTunes, and it's really helpful.
Mm. Thanks, Greg. Thanks for that suggestion.
You guys
are
welcome. Hey, it's Super Tuesday. We're running out of time here, but it's a big day for your brethren down yonder.
Yeah. Jeff. Yeah. The trumpeting is happening.
That's right.
Yeah.
So what do you think he's going to win the
I think
Super
that he's,
Tuesday?
I've actually been in prayer lately about it, and I mean, I don't mind saying that it deeply troubles me much of what he stands for and says.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't actually know what it is that he stands for and says. And I think it's really an indictment on a lot of self-proclaimed Christians that they are all for him. Mm. There tends to be uncritical, and I think it's an exposure of the idolatry of the politics among church people in the States, that we actually think that God, the way to bring God's kingdom is to get the right president. And the right president isn't always going to be the one who believes all the stuff I believe, but he's going to be the straight-talking, not, you know, wall-building, Muslim-hating Trump. And I, it's actually sickening to me. So, yeah, I have a vote, and I'm in great distress because I don't love any of the candidates, but that's not the first time. But at the end of the day, right, I mean, people are going to end up making their choices based upon their convictions, and they'll go their way, and God is on his throne, and he hasn't vacated it, and there are things that the church will learn and grow through regardless of who it is that's... You know, and just because the Republican nominee is not the guy that I might like, it doesn't mean that, you know, the Lord is, his arm is short. He will use all of these things for his glory and for the good of his people. I'm sure of it. But it's just hard sometimes when you watch it and go, ugh. Anyway, so I'm not a big fan. You're a big fan, Paul. You're a bit of a U.S. politics guy. You like the follow the U.S. politics guy.
Well, I listen to... a few times a week, usually I listen to a podcast by a guy named Albert Mohler. What's the title of it?
The Briefing.
The Briefing.
The Brief.
And
the Briefs.
And Mohler always, I mean, every day he talks about the headlines, what's going on. And so he's talking a lot.
The U.S. headlines, yeah.
Yeah, in the U.S. in particular. Sometimes Canadian stuff comes up when it has to do with religious liberty and things. But usually vast majority of the time it's American things. And he's been bringing up the fact that over the last couple of days, the fact that when the media brings up the fact that evangelicals are the ones voting for Donald Trump, and he's winning the evangelical vote.
Oh, that's a loose term.
Yes. So this word evangelical does not mean kind of what it traditionally has meant.
No.
And it's gotten to be this point where it's the same as just saying like Protestant. So you've got this wide range of people within that. So people that are just identifying it because, so I live in Mississippi, therefore I'm evangelical. And they don't look at their lifestyle. They don't read the Bible. They don't go to church. They don't pray. But yet I'm evangelical and therefore
yeah, it makes you
I'm
almost
voting
want
for
to,
Donald Trump.
It makes you almost want to ban the term, to be honest with you.
Yeah.
As you know, people have asked me before, you evangelical, I always want to say, well, what do you mean? Like politically or doctrinally, or as if there is a doctrinal center to evangelicalism. Like I don't know how to even use that term. It's funny you use the word Protestant. There's a guy named David Wells years ago who wrote a book called The Courage to be Protestant. And he argued in the book, we just need to use the word Protestant now because it's probably more clarifying than evangelical even. Which is funny because historically evangelical is a subset of the Protestants.
Right.
But nowadays, for me to say I'm a Protestant is actually to clarify me as being distinct from this political group that's trying to save the world through the right president.
Yeah, fair enough.
Which, by the way, is not, vote for a good president, in the States. Vote for parties in Canada that are, that are going to represent what you believe to be the values of Scripture. And that's great.
Mm-hmm.
And we have a responsibility for the good of our community and the common good to do all that kind of thing. I just, sometimes my heart hurts a bit for my country.
For sure.
And for what's happening there. And believe me, I've received my fair share of mockery over Trump being...
Mockery?
Yeah. I've had a lot of good Canadians.
Canadian? Or just because you're American?
Yeah, let me know what they think of the U.S. having him as... Like, they just can't believe. Which, of course, I keep wondering, what? How? But you know what? Like...
Because all our politicians are so good up here.
No, it's our friend. One of our friends recently said it to me this way. He said, you have a cell phone that ends up breaking, and you try four or five different things, and then finally you're like, and you just slam it against the table. That's the Trump move, right? That's the picture of what people are doing in the U.S. in voting for Trump. They're just, you know what? Maybe if we just hit it really hard, we'll vote for someone who can hit it really hard, and see if that works. And yeah. What's fear? Like I was a history major in college, and that's what's a little bit frightening to me is that in the past, when people have done that, they have voted for certain people, and I'm not comparing Trump to Hitler here. I'm just saying that
other people are.
Hitler was elected as a response to a time period where nothing was working to save the German economy, basically. And Hitler came along and he's like, well, I can do it. I mean, I've got all this other stuff, these other policies about Jews and stuff, but they're part of the problem. And so I'm going to set them straight. So, I mean, like when I hear him talk about, immigration and the Muslims being the problem, I'm like, man.
Right. No, I mean, if you could sum up Hitler's campaign, it would have been make Germany great again.
Yeah.
Right?
Totally.
Yes.
It totally would.
And that's what's frightening is that don't resort to, just like you might say to your kids, don't bash it, right? That's not going to solve the problem. Mm. That's what I want to say to all my friends in the States, my kinsmen. Don't bash it. Mm. Okay? It's not going to help it.
Mm. Well, this was a good time. We talked about Trump and hell and lying and the Oscars. It's good.
And Poochie.
Poochie, thanks for doing the work again, man. You did really well. Appreciate that. Hey, if you have questions you want to have the Extra team answer, send them to extra@northview.org. You can Google Poochie on The Simpsons, get a little taste for why we think Matt looks like him. He's being a good sport, but he has to because he has to sit there quietly.
And hey, one other thing. We had baptisms this past weekend, and if you were encouraged and you haven't been baptized yet, but you saw that and you were like, yeah, I want to be baptized, go on our website. We've got baptism classes coming up in April and May, and I think baptisms are going to be...
Both campuses, Mission and Abbotsford, we're going to have classes.
And the baptism, I think, is going to be out in Mission at Camp Luther in June.
It is,
So, yeah, if you were encouraged by that, which I know many people were, I mean, we had tons of people here on the weekend. It was awesome. Do that.
Yeah.
Do that.
It's good. All right. Thanks, guys.